Okay, so I'm going to skip through some of these slides. They're basically talking about the kind of the Mongol history throughout Russia. With this particular slide, we're talking about the power void that gets created when the Mongols leave, and it helps give rise to the Tsars. One of the definition, the couple definitions that I want to address is this is accretion. Is one term is accretion, and that's basically how Russia grew. You know, if we go back through and compare this Russia growth versus European growth, particularly like Great Britain, Spain, and France, and Portugal. You know, how did those countries grow? Those countries basically grew by imperialism. They would go through and colonialism, mercantilism. They would basically build ships and sail around the world and look to see who was out there, look to see what people existed, see what those people made. What did they make that was worth something? What did they have that they may not have recognized that was worth something? Gold, silver, tobacco, those types of things. And they would try to find out a way of exploiting it. Well, the Russians weren't, they didn't build ships. They didn't have a huge maritime fleet which they sent around the world. They basically colonized their own landscape. So they had a huge landscape with which to explore and to colonize, and so they didn't really build the navy to sail around the world. They were mostly just interested in exploring their own territory. And that was sort of the responsibility of these Russian Cossacks, as I have demonstrated here on this slide. So their imperialism was basically through conquest of adjacent land rather than building a navy to go through and create colonies around the world. Russia was very interested in conquering their quarrelsome neighbors, eliminating the Tatar threat, or any other threats that might have been around them. The British Empire was the strongest empire at that point of time, though they were challenged by the French and a little bit by the Spanish. They were the dominant kind of superpower for a couple hundred years. Afghanistan, in reference to number two, buffer areas, Afghanistan was created as a buffer between Great Britain and Russia. Finland was created as a buffer between Sweden and Russia. So some of the states that exist today were created to prevent opposing external forces to Russia from interfering within Russian politics and vice versa. They really wanted to explore their landscape as well too. There was lots of stuff to see, lots of things to exploit, lots of stuff to find, furs and gold. One point that people sort of miss out on is furs really helped build the United States. The furs trade really helped build Canada, and it really helped Russia as well too. There's a few Russian settlements that archaeologists have found along the west coast of the United States, British Columbia, and Canada. And of course, Alaska used to be a Russian territory until we bought it from them. Russians were very interested in spreading Christianity among the different cultures that they would run across, because again, this is a very ethnically diverse, particularly once you push into Central Asia and across to the east. You have people who have not, you know, been exposed to Christianity, and so some of these cathedrals would be built. Some of the most elaborate cathedrals in the world that would be built in Russia. And you can look up these little kind of onion bulbs that are very indicative of Russian cathedrals. Each one of those means something. The gold ones tend to mean Jesus Christ, and the different shapes and colors and stripes tend to mean they could focus on disciples. Sometimes they're different saints, but generally the gold bulb is always the highest one, and usually the gold bulb always refers to Jesus. Some people want to escape serfdom or some type of repression due to taxation, or maybe have their own land. Because again, we're talking about a very long history of having someone else be your master, and a lot of these people got tired of that, or their families were tired of it. So once things sort of opened up after the Tatars left, people tried to go out and find them. Kind of stake their own claim, even though that wouldn't last very long under this when the Soviets came to power. These next slides discuss a few of the important czars within Russia, or a few of the important leaders. Ivan the Great was would be he was an important leader within Russia. He was not the first czar. The first czar was Ivan the Terrible. He's not a nice guy. You should read up on him. He's kind of a horrific personality within Russia as well too. You'll want to read up on the beginnings of on some of the reasons why there was a revolution within Russia. Who the major players were within Russia. The Bolsheviks would eventually win. The communists would eventually win. There were actually capitalists within Russia, but they were not particularly popular and the minority. And, and consider the time span for this as well, too. We're talking about the first part of the 20th century. There's a huge movement worldwide. There's lots of controversy going on worldwide. We've got revolutions occurring in China. We've got revolutions occurring in Russia. There's a lot of convulsive attitudes going on across the world. We're very close to the beginning of World War One, and so it's a very conflicting time within in the world in world history. It's a very interesting time as well too. We've got lots of new thoughts and new political thinkings. Karl Marx has been writing for a few decades. In fact, he's probably dead by now or thereabouts, because most of his writings were done in the latter part of the 19th century. So it's a very interesting, but time of conflict globally. Eventually, Lenin will take power for a little while in the Soviet Union and help establish a framework within Russia. He would die. Some people would say he's assassinated, and Stalin would take over. Even though he was in 1942, he was recognized as Time's Man of the Year. If they had known what had happened prior to that, they probably would not have nominated him as or made him the Man of the Year.